Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Nancy, Kim Stickney. It's great to be part of this group presenting today on the operation of financialization, financial forces, which are an increasingly powerful driver of urban reform throughout the world. My topic is the spatial operation of finance in the Dutch East India Company's 17th century impacts on the joint development, I'm arguing, between Batavia, which is present-day Jakarta, and Amsterdam. Both were constructed largely in the 17th century. And one of the novel claims I stumbled on in the process of producing this work is the prospect that in many ways, Batavia and Amsterdam are really the north and south sides of the same city, given how fundamentally integrated the two economic systems were formed. Before I jump in, I want to not just reinforce the pitch for the Global Urban History Project, but also its sister organization, the Global Architectural History Teaching Collaborative. There are some cards down in the sign-in center if you're interested. This organization was established to provide teaching materials so that when we teach history, we are not locked into simply replicating the history we were taught. We are not limited by our narrow research interests, but we actually gain access to topics and materials that might allow us to teach with greater confidence topics that we were not taught, topics that venture beyond the boundaries of Europe and North America, and deep into Africa, Latin America, Asia, and to periods prior to the modern period, which is an increasingly threatened component of the curriculum. So I please encourage you to check us out. Check out it's basically a distribution of four teaching materials, PowerPoint slide shows for you to take advantage of. And I'd be happy to answer questions about that work after the talk. So the starting point for this research, although it dives deep into the 17th century, it's a very contemporary point of origin, where in my dissertation research on the late 20th century formation of property markets and their impact on the formation of the city of Jakarta and its larger region, I came across an interesting fact about the 1974 law that was passed that really established property and as a financial instrument that has become so important, not just in Jakarta, but globally, as has been referred to in other presentations. Understanding that the financialization of the built environment could have severe impacts on housing availability for especially the poorer populations, a remarkable thing happened. They passed a law that said, for every luxury house you build, you must build 9 other non-luxury houses in the same development, and there's no getting around it. You also must provide infrastructure and public facilities that are open to all residents of all 10 of the units, and a ratio of 9 to 1. So it's a remarkably progressive rule that had almost zero impact because the political will to enforce it was not there. And even my beloved and esteemed colleagues from Indonesia and from academia were quick to reassure me that, of course, it's impractical to enforce such an unrealistic measure. And I was always left dumbfounded by my otherwise intelligent and socially responsible colleagues. They just simply taken for granted that this was not a reasonable expectation of real estate. And so in digging into these other issues brought me way back in history to the 17th century, where the central premise of this paper, now I'm going to read it because it's thick. The 16th and 17th century Dutch disdain for ostentatious display was codified in sumptuary laws, restricting what was acceptable to wear in public. When the Dutch arrived in Java, they encountered three things: a strict hierarchy of race and occupation-based social categories, two, a codified set of norms for clothing, language, and behavior, very much like the sumptuary codes of Europe, and three, a spatially structured built environment ranging from the gated residential enclaves, so gated communities basically pre-existing before the Dutch arrived, things we know as kampong today in Southeast Asia. Ranging from the kampong, the gate, basically gated residential enclaves, race-based, to the nested courtyards of the royal palace. In building Batavia, after meeting the challenges of fortification and defense against external threats, and the second requirement of an effective port city are all the logistical considerations of warehouses in close proximity to waterways, the canal geometries of cities. Once those two criteria were satisfied, a third very interesting criteria, which is the focus of this work, is the need to develop methods and mechanisms for a non-Dutch majority population can be controlled by a handful of Dutch officers. And so it's a question of managing the internal threats. And I realized in writing the paper that a significant part of this argument is dependent on access to a knowledge of how Javanese face works, which is not from the archive. It actually stems from a fluke of economic recession that drove me out of the architecture business and into a three-month grant to look at the urban form of a central Javanese city, which turned out to be a royal city. And I stretched the three-month grant into a four-year stay, largely because I was invited by the king of Java to serve as his architect for 4 years in the restoration of different parts of the palace. And so my the spatial structure of social categories is largely informed by my direct experience of it as it has survived into the late 20th century during my time in the palace in central Java. And the interesting thing about this palace is its unpalatial character. It's really falling apart due to lack of financial resources. Any money they had to be committed to the sustaining of the rituals required to maintain the balance between heaven and earth. So if a volcano erupted, they would perform a specific ceremony in part of the palace. And if there was political unrest in the area of the island of Java, a different ceremony would be performed in a different part of the palace. So the most important sacred object of the palace, or of the kingdom, was the palace itself, although it was not an opulent set. And in addition to this use of the palace complex as a spiritual talisman with imbued with power, was a very strict segregation of space. The spatial structures of the palace were such that, which extended up to the boundaries of the kingdom. But as you enter the city, you pass through the gates of the city, and before you pass through the gates, you need to evaluate whether you are worthy in an external appearance and an interior state of mind to enter through the gates of the city. And then once you're in the city, to enter the gates at the front of the palace, again, repeat. And it happens through layer after layer of entry to the center of the palace. And typically there'd be a gate. At each gate there would be a mirror. On the right, you look at your outward appearance to make sure you're dressed properly, just like the sumptuary codes of Europe. And then in the left mirror, you address your internal state to see if your state of mind qualifies you to enter. And there was also a very clearly stratified social hierarchy that would allow one to wear one batik pattern in the sarong or a different batik pattern in the sarong. And there would be dozens of different distinct levels encoded in the batik pattern. A few of the more blunt signals are the sash was required to enter the palace as a sign to the Queen of the South Seas, confirmed by the guards posted at each gate, that one is a friend of the royal household. So the point here is that it's a very highly stratified social structure that manifests spatially. And I came to think of this as a cultural construct. And it was replicated, since it survived to the point of video technology existing. There are certain body positions that were also prescribed. European chairs would disappear as you come towards the center of the palace. Shoes would go away, different costumes. The closer you get to the center and the closer you get to the king, the more controlled the clothing, the language. The Javanese language has multiple vocabularies signifying different levels of respect. You can't stand, so you would have to duck walk up towards the king to sit cross-legged before him. And so it was a very ritualized, codified, spatial construct linked with clothing and behavior. So this is not the kind of thing that shows up in an archive, so I need to kind of give that little intro. To get to the point where it was not a one-way, given how strong these characteristics of Javanese culture were, it was not a one-way imposition of Dutch norms onto subject peoples of the Dutch East Indies. It was very much a two-way, there's evidence that there was a two-way exchange. I like this slide because it shows that not only did the king, Papa Boano X, embrace the Dutch military iconography of the sash and medals and the outfit, but the Dutch resident also is embracing the very Japanese practice of royalty qualifying you to have an umbrella carried over your head as a symbol of authority and power. And so the Dutch embrace this iconography as a way to establish the hierarchy in the Dutch East Indies. But before we get back to that, for those of you interested in the physical form of port cities, which I know is a big part of this session, or of this conference, just showing you, getting back to the idea that Amsterdam and Batavia grew out of a similar set of forces at a similar time. Simon Stebbins' brilliant engineering formulation of the ideal port town is less characteristic of Amsterdam itself because of the concentric canal pattern of Amsterdam, although you can still see elements of the fortification and especially the relationship between the canals and the blocks. There's first and foremost the defensive military fortifications, which are an essential prerequisite for a successful port town. But in addition to that, there's a very complex balancing of the ideal proportion of waterway and warehouse capacity in the smallest possible place to have the most efficient port town, which was Stebbins' brilliant solution. At around the same time, and these two maps are made within the same decade of each other, you see a more something closer to the ideal was achieved in Batavia because it was a new construction. You see the fortification at the mouth of the harbor. You see the canal geometry close to the ideal proportion of waterway to warehouse capacity. But then you see a few other things that are quite different. One thing to point out, especially for those interested in how markets work, is that Amsterdam was able to respond to price fluctuations in the Amsterdam exchange instantaneously because a slight rise in the price of lumber would send citizens scurrying to their attics, hoisting out the lumber onto the quays, which doubled the streets, but basically it was to load onto barges, get it to market, and take advantage of the slight price advantage until the price went back down and then they would stop. This is part of the reason why Amsterdam dominated the global European, or European dominance of exchange in the 17th century, because they were printing price sheets that established the price of commodities all over Europe. And part of the way that market operated is by the trust that was made possible in part by the architectural form of the Amsterdam Exchange and the decorum and sumptuary regulations regarding behaviors in the Amsterdam Exchange itself. So the symbols of authority in Batavia are matched in the marketplace on Dam Square in Amsterdam. There are two paintings, this one at Dam Square, showing some important institutions of market exchange, and a polyglot cast of characters from all over the world in the foreground. And within 6 years, this other painting is painted of Batavia, showing a very similar hustle and bustle of a polyglot, diverse citizenship of the two port cities, very cosmopolitan setting, with the fortress, the governor general, the marketplace, the shipbuilding, and the gallows to reassure people that order is being kept in social order. You see sumptuary code examples of a very fashionable couple, a demonstration of the tolerance of the Dutch even after the war with Spain. You see a Spaniard freely moving about the market. You see a celebration of the fact that the Ottomans allowed in the Dutch before anybody else as trading partners earlier in the century. And you see the Dutch traders. The Way House here, the new town hall with the Merchants Bank, and the Amsterdam Exchange off to one side. A previous paper looked more specifically at the decorum of behaviors inside the Amsterdam Exchange that led to the establishment of the first open market. The people trading in certain spices would gather at a certain column, so it was a very high concentration of both the maximum number of sellers and the maximum number of buyers, which is the key prerequisite for establishing reliable market prices, which then was the basis of spreading its price sheets globally. Looking more closely at the people in the foreground here, you see this mixed-race couple in the foreground breaking the sumptuary laws of the time by using an umbrella as a carried by a servant behind them. The sumptuary codes had to be revised multiple times to control the people from moving beyond their rank and status. And this is on the move. The final point is that the map, going back to the map at the top of it, it was more than just a map. It was also a directory which operated to reinforce the spatial controls to the point of actually showing the house numbers of the Dutch officers and listing their names. So it was very much a literal directory. This was the most fashionable block of the city. And then as opposed to the populations that were highly segregated by identifying specific Chinese classes and separating them into very small groups and putting them in specific neighborhoods. And the interesting thing to note here is that in the Dutch Quarter, there are bridges freely linking block after block while allowing canal access to the whole fabric. Whereas here, the canals, because the number of bridges are so few, the canals act as barriers to the free flow of movement, which would have been controlled by guards at each gateway, reading the social, racial, class identity of each human body approaching the checkpoint through their costume, through their mode of conveyance, just to bring it back to the present. I was shocked and surprised to find guards at the front of the luxury shopping mall in Jakarta doing a similar read of every person approaching the shopping mall, determining who could enter the shopping mall and who could not enter the shopping mall. Just one last slide that brings it back to the operation of the financial forces of real estate development. Similarly, are operate with the prerequisite of this kind of profound segregation, because we see similar gateways and formal arrangements of the gated communities of the real estate boom from the 1980s onward in Indonesia. Thank you.